The following program was funded in part by Toyota, AT&T, Baldwin Richardson Foods, Lincoln Financial Group, American Airlines. A complete list is available at thehistorymakers.org. He was born in the heart of the Mississippi Delta. His humble beginnings belied his fate as the King of the Blues. His name, B.B. King. And the History Makers is proud to present An Evening with B.B. King. And now to our host, R&B legend, Mr. Isaac Hayes.
It's great to be here on this stage for the cause, the History Makers Video Oral History Archive. Think of those we lost: Maynard Jackson, Gregory Hines, Barry White. And that's why both B.B. King and I are here tonight. We want to promote archives as a chance to record living history, relevant, rich history. Had it not been for my grandmother and her wisdom, I would not be here tonight. And that is why the blues community is here.
I want you to know that Purvis Spann started B.B. King, had B.B. King at my nightclub, 55th and State. I crowned B.B. King the King of the Blues. And he has won the crown well.
He had just got paid for doing his first hit. I think it's, here it is, 3 o'clock in the morning. I can't even close my eyes.
Now here it is, 3 o'clock in the morning.
I was coming home from school and I saw a pink Cadillac sitting in front of the house. And I went in and I looked and it was money like laying all over the floor and I'm going like, woo.
It's 3 o'clock in the morning, baby.
B.B., when he crossed over there, they found out where the blues came from. Cause when he hit the bandstand, man, he just like a preacher, man, in church.
He was a big fan of T-Bone Walker, yes. T-Bone was one of the people that he patterned a lot of his sound after. And with the sound he came up with, it became the B.B. King sound, you know, where it came out, yes.
He got his own style. And when I hear him, I don't hear nothing but B.B. And it's a sound that you can't forget. Once you know it, you can't forget it.
B.B. plays slide music without a slide. I think music is like a fingerprint, you know? Nobody have the same fingerprint. The techniques that he have, ain't nobody can really copy it, because I think that's his soul.
My favorite B.B. King song would be The Thrill Is Gone.
The Thrill Is Gone. That's the masterpiece.
The second B.B. King song would be Woke Up This Morning. Woke up this morning, my baby was gone. I woke up this morning, my baby was gone. I feel so bad, I was all alone.
When he said, everybody wants to know why I sing the blues. Oh yeah. Everybody wants to know why I sing the blues. Yes, I've been around a long time. People and I really pay my dues. Oh yeah, that's a good one for me.
Well, I've been around a long time.
Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready for the star of the show tonight? We talking about the undisputed king of the blues. How about a big round of applause for Mr. B.B. King?
Everybody, tell everybody that B.B. King's in town. I got a dollar and a quarter, and I'm just round the clown. But don't let nobody play me cheap. I got 50 cents more that I'm gonna keep.
Let the good times roll.
Let the good times roll. I don't care if you're young or old. Get together, let the good times roll.
I thought that was me for a minute. I'm standing up there and I'm going, you know. And the lady was saying, get out there, get on out there. I always do what ladies tell me.
It's good to see you, B.
Thank you.
You're looking good.
You want my glasses?
But you gotta stand up too, y'all.
Thanks a lot, Isaac.
But you're everywhere, man. You're on TV. In the papers, at History Makers, you can really give Reverend Jackson a run for his money. You know, you had a birthday last month, didn't you?
Yeah, 16th of September, I made 78.
Oh! And still touring.
Yeah.
The new album?
Yes.
It's the Year of the Blues.
Yes.
They say that, but I think every year is the Year of the Blues.
Has been all my life.
And now you're living in Las Vegas when you're not touring, right?
Yes, I do.
Well, you know, but Las Vegas hasn't always been your home.
No, I'm from Indianola, Mississippi, my dad.
All right.
But my second home is Memphis, Tennessee. Because my dad said I was born near a little place called, all the natives call it Itabena.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
It's spelled Itabena, so we call it Itabena. And people that don't live there call it Itabena.
Mm-hmm. I'm guilty of that. You know, Purvis Spann, you know, your former manager was born in Itabena.
Well, who is that?
Purvis Spann, not too far from where you're born.
What did he do? Oh, yeah, that's my friend. My friend. Many, many moons.
Well, you know, also Marion Barry.
Oh, yes, I've heard of him too.
And Reverend James Bevel.
Reverend Bevel?
Yeah.
Oh, he was really instrumental in the civil rights movement.
Big time.
Yeah. Why didn't you come from there?
I wish I had. I'm glad I didn't. Because I'm sure you got some stories to tell. Tell us about growing up there.
Well, growing up, I had never heard of the ghetto like you hear today, people saying, mm-hmm. Oh, the ghetto, this ghetto, and I'm trying to think, well, ghetto, what's that? I was born poor, yes. I was born in, you know, in the country, so, but we didn't have ghetto, we had gravel roads and stuff like that.
Right. But you know, a funny thing about that, I was born in Covington, Tennessee. We didn't realize that we were poor.
That's right.
Because everybody was living the same way.
Yeah, but that was a few had things I wished I had. And I was scared to borrow them without their permission.
Well, now, you were born Riley B. King.
Right.
Now, what about this white plantation owner named Jim O'Reilly?
My dad's boss was named Jim O'Reilly, and my dad was naming me after him because they were such good friends.
Oh, okay.
So when I got old enough to kind of realize what was going on, and I asked my dad, I said, you know, you named me after Mr. O'Reilly, and he said, yes. I said, well, what happened to the O in my name. My dad looked at me and laughed and said, you didn't look Irish enough.
Now, your mother was Baptist.
Yes.
Your grandmother, she preferred
Church of God in Christ, which is my faith today. And my pastor was the one that made me want to be a musician. Boy, that man could
Reverend Archie Fair.
Reverend Archie Fair. He was the guy that played the guitar so good till I knew if I had a message I wanted to get to God, just tell him.
That's it.
But you know, Isaac, it's sort of funny. All of my life, I never felt like that again until about 8 or 9 years ago, I met the Pope. I went to the Vatican and met the Pope. Mm-hmm. And that's the second time in my life that I felt like if I had a message, I could, you know, get it over.
Shoot it up there.
So, and the funny thing, I must tell you, they're not shut up.
No, you.
I gave the Pope a guitar. You know, he can play.
Pope can play guitar?
People laughing, but the Pope played guitar before he became the Pope.
Wow.
But anyway, after I gave him the guitar and we were leaving, my band was with me. They say, you know, do you hear that? I said, what? The Pope is playing The Thrill Is Gone.
Oh, God.
They were lying, of course. Yeah, but he can play, though.
You were 8 or 9, your mother took sick and died, leaving you to be raised by your grandmother.
True.
And 5 years later, your grandmother passed.
It wasn't that long, about 2 years.
2 years? Mm-hmm. Okay.
About 2 years, and after she died, I lived alone working for the same people that my mother and grandmother had worked for. It was tough, but I felt kind of like you said a while ago. I thought it was tough on everybody, so I'm just one of them that was tough on. You know, I didn't have things. I had to go to school walking. I had to walk about 5 miles a day to school. But I noticed the white children had a bus, but we didn't. And I just thought it was like that. But it was one teacher. I had a teacher called Professor Luther H. Henson. And he used to tell me things that I later heard. I even heard Dr. King say some of the things that he told me, that things wouldn't always be like that. I remember him telling me, he was one of the first I ever heard to say, you know, one day you will be, people will praise you or think of you for what you do, your deeds, not your color.
Wow.
And gosh, you know what? They do that today.
Speaking of life back in the Delta, let's take a look.
Everything leads me back to the feeling of the blues, or the feeling that I get from playing or singing the blues or hearing others sing and play it. In fact, I think life itself is the blues.
From Catfish Row in Vicksburg, Mississippi, to the lobby of the Peabody Hotel in Memphis, Tennessee, the Mississippi Delta is a floodplain between the Yazoo and Mississippi rivers known for its fertile soil. Here, ownership was concentrated in the hands of a few white plantation owners. Here was the land of cotton.
One guy would take his hoe and chop way out in front of everybody else. And usually you would hear this guy sing.
Oh, wake up in the morning. About the break of day.
And here in the Delta of Riley King's childhood, a black man dreamed of owning a mule. But by the time Riley was a teen, driving a tractor for a salary was a better bet than owning a mule. The lush sounds and colors of life on the Delta seeped into Riley King's soul. From his Aunt Mima's Victrola, he first heard the music of blues legends Lonnie Johnson and Blind Lemon Jefferson, not to mention his famous cousin, Booker White. Gospel and blues permeated his landscape, from the church to the 10-cent street vendors who introduced him to performers like Louis Armstrong and Fats Waller. By the time Riley was a teenager, he had purchased a guitar and formed his first group, the famous St. John's Gospel Singers.
Look, I've got a ledger here. I've got Riley King's ledger. Monthly furniture, $2.50. Occasionally, work, $4 across the canal. A pair of pants, $1. A wrench, 50 cents. 3 yards of cotton sack, 40 cents. And interest, $1.12, $1.20, 39% compounded every 6 months. November settlement, $1.18. Leaving you $7.54.
I was trying to pay my bills, man.
But, you know, that's sharecropping.
Yes.
You know, my grandparents were sharecroppers, and it was designed that those people working never could get out of debt.
Yeah, I guess you could say that, because I never did.
Well, but you know, one thing though, you beat the odds. You paid it off in 1940.
Yes, yes I did.
And then you reconnected with your dad.
Yes.
And you also saw him as a new family in Lexington.
Yes. I noticed then I had three sisters and a brother. So I felt like for once I had a family.
And you saw something.
Yeah,
the man was lynched.
Yes.
In Kilmichael.
I saw that they had a place called Poplar Creek, an area there where they would hang people. But one of the strangest things I can remember while I was going to school in Lexington, there was a person had been lynched there, a young man, and had been castrated, and they drug him around. So that's one of the things that have stayed with me through the years.
So you went back to the Delta?
Yes.
And start back picking cotton.
Mm. I'm a pretty good cotton picker too, dude.
Look, so was I.
You pick cotton?
Two rows and a snatch row.
Hey. All right, you know what you're talking about.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead. Now, you got drafted. What did you serve?
Well, I went to Hattiesburg. They have a camp that's still there called Camp Shelby. Mm-hmm. At that time, I'd never heard the word superstar like you hear quite often today, but I was a superstar before I was drafted in. Mm-hmm. Tractor driver. Superstar tractor driver.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, anyway, we was raising produce for the government, so when I went in, they didn't ever give us complete basic training. They give you, instead of the 3 months, you would get like 2 months, 20 or 25 days, and then reclassify you and send you back.
At Camp Shelby, that's in German, POWs.
Yes.
Picking cotton.
Right.
In the cotton field, they got some kind of like preferential treatment. So how did you feel?
Well, compared to us, yes, they did, because we had to be in the fields from kin to kin.
Kin to kin, that's right.
Kin mean till you can see. Can't mean till you cannot see. So they'd bring these people over about 8 or 9 o'clock in the morning. They'd pick till 3 or 4 in the evening, and they'd take them back to the camps. And we had to be there, like I said, from kin to kin. That hurt. And we was dying with them and for them.
You also continued to play, no matter what happened.
Yeah.
You stayed with your music.
My music was my friend. It was a way of soothing myself. It's kind of like giving a baby one of those pacifiers. Mm-hmm. I'd play the music and forget all the other things. Everything else that was happening to me, bad, or things I didn't understand or didn't like. I play, and it seemed to go away.
Well, you had some idols, too, some people that you looked up to, like Django Reinhardt and John Lee Hooker.
Lonnie Johnson. Mm-hmm. I was crazy about Lonnie Johnson, another guy called Blind Lemon, a Texan. I was crazy about Blind Lemon. And, of course, I learned about jazz, and there was a guy called Charlie Christian, a Frenchman. Frenchman called Django Reinhardt, and then finally another Texan called T-Bone Walker.
T-Bone Walker.
And when I heard him, I went crazy for the guitar, and believe it or not, I still am. I'm crazy about melodies. I love those beautiful melodies, like By the Time I Get to Phoenix.
But you know what? You came up with a lot of wonderful melodies, and you stay with the blues.
That's all I know.
Blues got melodies.
True, but that's all I know. But they never, you know, By the Time. I could never do that.
B, you can.
Okay, you teach me.
I heard you do On My Word of Honor.
Yes.
Remember that one?
Yes, I remember.
See?
On my word of honor.
See?
Let's don't go no further.
Well, now, you had a tractor accident. And you left Indianola and headed to Memphis. Now, what made you leave? What made you? It sounded like you got out in a hurry. So, what happened?
I was hoping you wouldn't do this to me, but you know, youngsters usually don't think they reason very well. And during this time, as you mentioned earlier, I was singing with a group called the St. John Quartet, and we were supposed to play someplace that night. And I'd been driving the tractor since noon, and I brought it in to the tractor barn. Well, in that area of Indianola, the Mississippi River used to quite often water would flood down.
Crest, yeah, yeah.
So they had, what?
It would flood.
So they built this house way up off of the foundations way up. So we could usually drive the nose of the tractor under the house. But I've been plowing all evening, and so the tractor's really hot. So I'm in a hurry, and I run it up there and got it to the place where it's supposed to be, shut it off, and jumped off the tractor.
Mistake.
Bad mistake. All of a sudden, the tractor started up again by itself. And it ran on up under there. And I ran out of Mississippi.
Well, now, you went to Memphis.
I went to Memphis. That's.
Well, let's look at the Memphis that you found.
For Riley B. King, Memphis was bustling and full of excitement. Beale Street became his home, and WDIA Radio in West Memphis provided his start. Before long, King was advertising for Pepticon Tonic.
He had a commercial called Pepticon Sure Is Good. You can get it anywhere in your neighborhood. And he'd play that every day. We'd hear it. If we want to hear about Pepticon, all we had to do is turn it on the station where B.B. King was.
He soon gained a loyal following, including Rufus Thomas. Riley was soon a DJ with a nightly gig at 16th Street Grill, and before he knew it, the Beale Street Blues Boy became the Blues Boy King, which was shortened to B.B. King. From Delta Country Boy to Memphis musician, Riley B. King had arrived.
Now, B, I can remember.
Please.
Look.
What?
Pepticon
Show
is good.
Oh, come on.
Pepticon Show is good. Pepticon Show is good.
You can get it anywhere in your neighborhood.
Man, I'm really
living.
Bring. it was a six chord you played on a guitar. I didn't know what it was at the time, but I know it was a six.
Oh, thank you.
It was a major six.
I still don't.
In the late 40s, you developed your own identity, your own style of playing, your own guitar voice. And out of this period, you developed the butterfly technique. You know, you would listen to country and western music, and I think, tell me if I'm right, you did a trio on the strings.
Yeah.
Was that the butterfly technique?
Well, whatever they call it, you know, people call me some everything. Sometimes it's like being black twice. I don't remember it all. But seriously, you know, a lot of the kids think that I push and pull like this, but it's actually just this, just that.
Oh.
And my ears tell me that it sounds similar to what they did with the bottleneck and what country musicians do with that steel guitar.
Slide, yeah. Mm,
yeah, that to me sounds so good.
How did your guitar become Lucille?
You really want me to tell you?
I really want you to tell me that. Inquiring mind wants to know.
First thing I like to say, Lucille's the only woman I ever had that never argues with me. I used to play over at a little place called Twist, Arkansas, and it used to get quite cold in winter. So we played there quite often in winter because I had no other place to go. So they would take something like a big garbage pail, half fill it with kerosene, set it in the middle of the dance floor. People dancing would dance around it, never disturb it. But one night, two guys start to fight, and one knocked the other one over on this container. When they did, it spilled on the floor. So when it spilled on the floor, it looked like a river of fire.
Whoa.
Oh, yes. And everybody started running for the front door, including B.B. King. But as soon as I got on the outside, then I realized I'd left my guitar inside. I went back for it. When I did, the building was a wooden building, burning rapidly and started to collapse around me. So I almost lost my life trying to save my guitar. The next morning, we found that these two guys was fighting about a lady that worked in the little nightclub. I never did meet her, but I learned that her name was Lucille. I named my guitar Lucille to remind me never to do a thing like that again. That was 1949. So she's still Lucille.
Still Lucille. Bahari Brothers.
Yes.
Tell me about them.
Bahari Brothers at that time was a young company. And they knew a young man that I'm sure you know, Ike Turner. So he was telling me that they were looking for new talent and he was trying to help them out. Loved it very much. I enjoyed working for them. Of course, I was getting a half a cent aside for a record. You know, that's one half cent per side. But I remember the time when I would have paid them to let me record. Mm. But the books were sort of like it was in Mississippi, because they, let's say that I owed you $10 and I gave you $7. But then you come up with a hard luck story and say, B, I really need $3 more. I just really, my house burned down, my dog, you know, got hit by a car, my old lady put me out and so on. And other than that, everything's all right, but I need $3. So they was gonna give me the $3 anyway. So they was good to me, I'm trying to say.
I know.
And I loved them for it, but the $3 they owed me already and I didn't know it.
That's the kind of games they used to play with all of us down there, especially down in the South.
I'm thankful to them today, because they really trained me well. They really did. But when they got through with you, with those small companies like that, you were ready or you went back to plowing.
It's true. With Robert Henry's help, you started to travel big cities, Chitlin Circuit.
Yes.
And you're on the road, riding that big red bus.
Big Red.
Now, why'd you laugh? I'm telling you, it's totally gonna make you sweat.
Big Red. That was, I had a friend that worked with me called Cato Walker.
I know Cato.
And Cato Walker put every kind of wire on there, including the wires, you know, what the kind of, your clothes hangers? He put that on there.
Tied everything to keep it rolling, right?
He kept it rolling. Kept it rolling.
Your first recording was with Bill Harvey.
Well, actually, my first recording I made for a company called Bullet out of Nashville. And I did four sides for them. And the people I had with me, you were too young to know, but I had old man Finest Newborn on drums. I had Calvin Newborn on guitar.
I know the Newborns.
You too young to know.
Finest the Professor?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I had him playing piano.
Wow.
Genius. He was too young at that time to get a union card, and I belong to 71. Still do.
That's right, that's Memphis, local 71. That's right.
At 71. And we had Ben Branch on tenor sax.
Dub.
That's the man.
Double brain,
that's
Ben Branch.
That's him. Yeah. And Thomas Branch on trumpet.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
And Sammy Jett on trombone.
Wow.
That was my first group.
Yeah,
very
good
first
musicians,
group.
Man.
And after we made those four sides, you know, it's a funny thing, I remember them today. How do you feel when your baby packs up to go was one side. I Got the Blues was two sides, you know, the second side. Take a Swing with Me and Miss Martha King. And so those were my four sides, which I wrote.
You wrote most of them.
I did?
Yes, you did.
They don't know about it. The company doesn't.
Look, I looked at your label, B.
Yeah, and you find King and Ling. I never didn't know who Ling was. King and Ling, and a few other names I can't remember completely. But anyhow, the only time I've ever stole anything in my life Herman Green and I broke in his dad's church. We didn't have no guitars. So we had a gig to do, so we broke in his. We didn't break in there to keep the guitar, we just wanted to borrow it. So we broke in the guitar, in the church, I should say, stole the guitar, went up to state line of Arkansas and Missouri, and we played the job, and on the way back, would you believe, we had a wreck.
Oh my God.
But we managed to get, we managed to get back to the church before the reverend got there. We put the guitar back in there, but we put $5 in it.
Okay, okay. No, I'll let you get away with that one.
Yeah.
You know, Herman is still playing in Memphis. In fact, on my recording, Never Can Say Goodbye, that's Herman doing the flute thing.
He's a great musician.
Yeah, he's great.
They taught me all of these songs, you know. They taught me How High Is the Moon,
yeah.
Body and Soul. Because my timing was so bad. I paid well, paid good. But oh God, if I'm playing a 12-bar blues, I may play 12-bar before I decide to change it.
Oh my God.
What I mean by that, for you that don't play blues, blues generally, as you know, you say a line, and after you say that line, then it's about the fourth bar, and you you go to four chord for the fifth bar.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I go all the way through to the 12th before I make the first change. So the guys, they say the best way to, let's fix this fool. You play this way. You play this way, you know, and you play this and this way, and mm-hmm. so on and so on. Mm-hmm. And they taught me a lot of great tunes, and that's how I got my first training in jazz. But it wasn't because they wanted to teach me, so they wanted to work easier. It made it better for them. You know, I was much older. They wanted to play in the band because I played well. I paid well, I should say.
Everybody did say B.B. plays good.
Well, I wanted the best with me. And they were.
Something also happened, and his name was Rock and Roll. Let's take a look.
It was the 1960s. Rock and Roll was changing America's music scene. Artists like Chuck Berry, Little Richard, and Ray Charles found crossover success, leaving behind traditional artists like B.B. King. King had no choice but to wait things out. His opportunity came when the Paul Butterfield Blues Band started to gain nationwide attention. They credited B.B. King as their main inspiration, and in the late 60s, B.B. King played for his first white audience at the Fillmore West. The audience gave him a standing ovation, and their applause was met with tears of joy.
B. Do you remember that night at Fillmore West? Can you describe how you felt that night?
Now you, I'm sure, most of all of us used to play the Fillmore.
Yeah, when Bill Graham's place.
Yeah. So it was then called just the Fillmore. So anyway, my agent, you know, had booked me there, and we get there, and I see all these long-haired kids. And the stairway leading up to the door was about the length of a, you know, big car, you know, maybe two car lengths, maybe. And they were sitting just body to body, seemingly talking to each other, you know. So I told my road manager, I said, we're the wrong place. So I told my road manager, I said, you better go and find the promoter and let's see what's going on here. I think my agent made a mistake. So he went in, and Bill Graham came out himself and said, no, be this right place. So he said, come on in. Now we got to pass these people. As I said, they sitting body to body. So you got to pass them to get in, get up to the door.
You like that?
And you know what? They seemed to just move over nice and quietly. Didn't call us no SOBs or nothing, just moving. Well, I'm used to that, you know, man. Uh-huh. Man, what you doing? Don't step on me. They did none of that. Now, as soon as I get inside, there are no tables, no bottles. I didn't see any bottles at all. And the people sitting on the floor, body to body. And I'm saying, oh God, oh. What am I into now? So I'm following Bill Graham, and he just stepping, you know, stepping over this one, over, trying to keep from stepping on them. But I'm really concerned about this. I've never seen people like this before. Mm-hmm. So we get to the dressing room, the old dressing room where somebody done cut the couch, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
I get in, I sit down, and I'm like this. I'm really tense, sort of like a cat in front of a dog. So I said, Bill, he said, yeah. I said, I got to have a drink. He said, B, we don't sell liquor in here. I said, don't care, I got to have a drink. So he said, okay, I'll send out and get you a bottle. So he did, and he brought it, and I had two, three good slugs of that. And I'm still not right. I'm just there, you know, but I'm not right at all. What I found, though, the kids knew me by my music, not by sight. They didn't know me, what I looked like, but they knew the music. So the best, I think, one of the best, I should say, introductions I ever had, when he got me back to the stage, he said, ladies and gentlemen, and it seemed like you could hear a pin fall, he said, I bring you the chairman of the board, B.B. King. And everyone stood up and they screamed and they yelled. I never had that happen to me before. Wow. So it got to me, I was so emotional, I started crying. So I'm thinking now, God, these people done stood up and they yelling, what am I gonna do? I'm really serious, I'm not joking. I don't know, what am I gonna do? I ain't never played to nobody look like this before. I started playing, they sit down, and I had about 45 minutes set. And they must have stood up at least 3 to 4 times doing that set. And that's the first time I ever noticed that there was what they call a crossover and there was a difference. And I still was scared to death.
Till in 1969, you released your biggest hit, Thrill Is Gone.
That's the one. And please tell me I can make another one.
But it won you your first Grammy Award.
Yes, it was the first.
Wouldn't y'all like to hear him do something? Huh?
After a while, it gets heavy. It's like ladies sitting on your knee.
I can tell it on yourself. That big red bus.
What key did you have? Oh, that's me. That's what I was trying to tell you a while ago. When we were sitting in the studio after recording, I'm sitting up there waiting for them to play the tune. And finally I said, Ben, when they gonna play? He said, that's you, fool. Don't you hear him? Did you tune it? Well, if you didn't, it sounds all right to me. Okay, want to do a down on it?
No.
Give me a 4/4. One, two, three. You would pick a day like today.
You see, any day. The thrill ain't gone.
Thank you, sir.
Thrill ain't gone. It's still here.
Guess what?
Oh, yes. Still here. You know.
You really got me, you know. I'm going to get you. Wait till we're off stage. I get you.
Well.
But I love you, so it's all right.
I love you, too. You know, you got the award, and now things are really beginning to hop. You took the Rolling Stones, Ike and Tina Turner. You appear on The Tonight Show and The Ed Sullivan Show, and you travel around the world.
90 different countries.
Audiences love you. Let's see this.
I've been downhearted, baby.
B.B. King was achieving widespread recognition for his talent and musical style. He performed, collaborated, and continued to innovate.
Baby, how blue can you get?
he has won the respect and love of fans around the world.
In Moscow, you kind of related with the peasants because you had humble beginnings.
Yes. Only thing different, though, the first time I went to Soviet Union, it seemed like everybody was, you know, I didn't do it. I don't know who did it, you know. Because the next time I went back, it was sort of like New York. But the first time, it seemed like, while it was Soviet Union, it seemed like everybody was like they was in, you know, near Poplar Creek, New Mississippi or something. I didn't know it. I don't know who did. It seemed like everybody was afraid, I'm saying.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah. They liked music. And when we came through East Germany, another time when I cried, it was a guy that was with us, touring with us. His brother was there in East Germany, and they wouldn't allow him to see him. And when we were on the bus, like, they had something like a long, you ever see these things when people trying to find money or something, they had this long handle?
Divining rod?
What, who?
That's water, I'm wrong, that's wrong, that's water.
You know, that's twice you done did that to me this evening. But they had this thing, but it had a mirror on it. And they'd go around the bus with this mirror and the guys be looking. And they had two or three of them, what I'm talking about. So I was afraid, very scared. And we had a lady with us that just talked. And so and so and so, and I'm an American citizen. Please.
Oh, God.
Will you just shut up, please? And finally, thank God, we got to Checkpoint Charlie. So, oh, God, thank you. I'm glad to be back here, you know. But it was a great experience. We found that the people were very warm and very nice. Mm-hmm. But they, I guess, had been through a lot of things, sort of like I was in Mississippi, you know.
B received an honorary doctorate degree from Yale University.
Yes.
In 1977. Born from Mississippi.
And that's the one thing I'm kind of sad to say. I can only say it to you if you promise not to tell. When you get to be my age, you get to place, you don't remember everything so well. Oh, I remember beauty, though. God, yes.
Talking about Lynn Whitfield out
That's
there.
That's the one I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Yes, Lord.
You know, you got some business endeavors, too.
Yes.
You got clubs, you got B.B. King's Club in Memphis.
That was the first one.
That's right.
Yeah.
In New York.
Yes, we got one on 42nd.
In Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And you also got one coming up in Nashville.
We just opened it.
Oh, that's it. Okay.
We opened that, and we got two in Connecticut. But I'm not a businessman. I've got a very smart manager and got a lot of people that believe in me. Mm-hmm. I got 2 cents, and they got millions.
Well, B, you know, you went on TV, I saw your commercial, talking about you had diabetes.
Yes, I'm a diabetic. I also have hypertension. They claim a lot of people of color have it. But I'd like to say this, hopefully somebody that maybe know about it or have it will pay attention. It's a silent killer. Mm-hmm. It will take you away. I sat and saw my sister, my oldest sister. They first amputated her legs right along here. Then again around here. And the last time before she passed up to here. And that hurts. But another thing that hurt, they have a funny way of checking your blood sugar. They want to go in your fingers. Now, a musician don't want that happening. And the minute they grab your hand, that it's, whoa, wait a minute. But thank God they got something now. It's one touch. Mm-hmm. You can touch yourself any place you like. So you don't have to hurt your fingers. I'm living pretty well now, 7-8. I feel good, feel wonderful.
That's great, that's wonderful. You know, you're opening a B.B. King Museum in Indianola in 2005.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's great. It's time. It's time. It's time.
The Chamber of Commerce of the city of Indianola and the surrounding area, including it, have been, and all the people are chipping in. It's going to be a $20 million project.
Whoa. Awesome. Now, before we leave, I want to ask you, what are you going to do you haven't done already?
I'd like to do a movie with, some actor or actress of today. I'm a big fan of Morgan Freeman.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Fellow Mississippian.
And there are many others. I would like to have a line more than, would you gentlemen care for Pepsi? No, seriously, that's one of the things I'd like to do. And I have several different types of albums I'd like to do before the end. But I remember reading once where the great entrepreneur Ford, of the Ford company, automobile company, he said if he went broke, and if he could borrow a dollar from each of his employees, he would still be a millionaire. So I believe today that if I could borrow a half a dollar from all of my friends, I could become a millionaire too.
Wow, I say a lot. I say a lot, dude. Well, you got mine. I'm okay. B, I would like to say that you've lived your life very well and still doing it. You're still working. You've done so much, you've meant so much to so many people. And you're a generous man, wonderful man. And I'm proud to be your friend, proud to be your fan. And all of these things that we talked about tonight and all those honors, and seeing where you came from, you overcame so much, you've done so much, and you're a role model for a lot of people, kids and grown-ups. I could go all night with this, but we see why they call you King. Thank you, my friend.
I've gone through a lot of bad times early parts of my life, but the good have always outshadowed and overshadowed the bad, if you will. The thing that you're doing for me now and what you're doing for me now make me think that I'm one of the luckiest people in the world. Thank you all, and God bless you.
We're all lucky, dude. Thank you, man.
The preceding program was produced by the History Makers, which is solely responsible for its content. Thank you.
For more information or to order your own copy of An Evening with B.B. King, please visit thehistorymakers.org or call 866-914-1900. That's 866-914-1900. The preceding program was funded in part by Toyota, AT&T, Baldwin Richardson Foods, Lincoln Financial Group, American Airlines. A complete list is available at thehistorymakers.org.